And we're live. Welcome to Echo Chamber, the session in between sessions. I feel like we haven't had an Echo Chamber session in a month and a half. I don't know about you guys. Well, I'm excited.
I mean, it's been a while since I've been one on one. I think I missed the last two, I think.
You missed the last two, and then we didn't have a session for a couple of weeks, and then we went to campaign two, and then last week, my fault, I'll fully take blame, I missed the session because I had other things going on, and so a month later, that's what it feels like. It's like, I'm excited just to chat about it. I was hoping to get a couple more people, but you know what, us three, we'll go with it, and you watch. Maybe Garrett will jump on, even though he couldn't join us in session. He likes to jump in here, so we'll see. But so we were just talking about it. We'll jump straight into the question, the Q&A portion. We were just talking about it, so we're preparing to go to this island, or I guess we got to the island, right? And we know there's going to be some skeletons and stuff. And I mentioned, you know, Mordai is going to want a fireball. Legion's going to want a fireball, and of course Barry just wants to use his divinity to turn, right? So it's awesome. Are you going to have pirate zombies? That was my question. Because it was
actually that's a very good possibility.
I like it. That's all I can think of, because it was an alliance between these necromancy and the pirates. Mm-hmm. And so if they fought, there's got to be a couple pirate zombies there, right?
there is a slight chance that may happen. Not saying it will. depends on how the dice roll.
So right. We just got to remember not to take any gold out of any chests that looks like, you know, might be of Spanish origin, something like that. That could end poorly for us.
We turn into the skeletons. I like it. Let's do it. We can't be killed. Let's take on the Kraken Society at that point, right?
I mean, you already have a Captain Jack, so.
It's true. We do. We have a Captain Jack. I like it. Oh, yeah, so that was all I could think of as you're telling us the story is, man, there's going to be some pirate zombies. I'm going to get to use turn. And then to hear Evan talk about fireball, I'm like, no, I'm not going to get to use it. But I'm sure there's plenty to go around, you know, plenty of fodder. And we talked a little bit about some crossovers and stuff. Did you get a chance to talk to G? Would you want to give us your idea? What can you give us, E?
No, nothing.
Oh, my gosh.
I have not talked to G about it yet, and it probably won't happen for a little bit, but we'll see. Yeah, it probably won't happen for a little bit, but yeah, I have a thought.
You're gonna make me put on my tinfoil hat and just come up with theories. I see how it is. What do you got, Rusty?
I was going to say, I'm really, and this was an accidental reveal, so I'm not going to go too much into it, but whatever our game of Minesweeper is.
I definitely thought of that as these little squares and these little black dots in the middle. I'm like, that's like Minesweeper. I'm going to go two to the left.
Yeah. There's a five popped up there, a three there.
I like
it. Actually?
Pretty accurate?
Maybe.
Sweet.
That's awesome. A little
I don't want to steal any thunder. I just, you know.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Accidental reveal, but
no, that's
I mean, you had the opportunity. I mean, it was perfect because you were like, check this out, this is what you're up against, but I'm gonna rearrange them next time. So I like that. What do you think they trigger though? I mean obviously he can't tell us anything, but what do you think, Rusty, what do you think they trigger?
I'm thinking they, like, summon more zombies or more monsters or whatever.
Okay.
Or, like, if you step outside of, you know, a certain path or whatever that you trigger some, like, Indiana Jones-style trap, maybe, where you have, you know, arrows shooting at you or it resurrects more skeletons or, you know, something like that. Almost like in, almost like in Nasana's Lair, you step over the bridge and, you know, here come all the undead, right? But with specific, like, target spots. Because I think those squares were bigger than 5 feet, right? But
yeah, yeah. That's 150.
Yeah. So basically a safe zone versus not safe zone or whatever.
So do you think the dots were the path, the safety path, or do you think the dots are the trigger? Because my mind went the other way.
My mind went that the dots are the safety path.
Okay, that's the way my mind went. If you follow the dots, you're safe.
Kind of reverse mind sweep.
Right. Okay.
But
I love the
I don't want to speculate too much and incriminate myself in the next session.
I mean, just be glad we don't have Griswold with us. Otherwise, every single skeleton
run straight, straight through.
Not just run, lay on your side and roll.
Big fucking 9 foot tall motherfucker doing cartwheels.
Exactly. I missed a few and he rolls back. Yeah. So that was definitely my thought process to follow the dots. Now obviously we don't know where the dots are anymore, but what do you think strategically? I'm going to be honest, this party doesn't seem to have much strategy. You know, I'm coming from Amrook to Barry, and I don't want the strategy on Barry, so I'm relying on somebody else to have strategy, and nobody else seems to bring it. I mean, Cleek flies over. Cleek's just going to fly over. That's his strategy.
I scout because I can be off the ground. Now, that may or may not help us. You know, they could be a... You know, I'm not imagining it's a simple pressure trap kind of thing, right?
Right.
You know, it might just be, hey, if your presence is detected within this, you know, this airspace from the ground up.
Yeah.
You know, my thoughts are I would be the scout to go ahead and see if I can suss out the safe path. But
yeah, that is our only strategy up to this point.
Yep.
You know, it's funny because as I was putting in, as I was kind of going through updating stats, I kind of had to go back through and watch part of the stream and everything, and I sat here and I'm watching going, you know, you guys have no strategy whatsoever when it comes to a fight, but I think this group clicks a little bit better than the Phandalin 5.
I think we planned our characters better instead of, yeah man, I'm gonna play a wizard because fuck it, or you know, Goliath sounds cool, or this sounds cool, or whatever sounds cool.
I am in complete agreeance with Rusty, as per usual. I think, you know, Evan, I'm gonna call you out. I love you, bud. But he's playing what he wants Griswold to be, and so therefore, you know, the people who may we've kind of flip flop roles, right? Like I'm no longer the strategy upfront person. I'm the guy kind of in the back healing people, throwing bless, doing this and that, and it's just we've role swapped. And I think that's why it feels like it clicks better.
Yeah. I mean, you know, like even seeing like Keegan, you know, forego a complete, you know, attack and everything and just double move and get into position on the knoll.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that move.
They could have sat back and just flinged you all night long.
Yeah.
I'm excited because... you know, fifth and sixth level is always kind of fun as a DM because, as me and my friend Ron always say, that's like the level where the kid gloves kind of come on.
Yeah.
I'm kind of excited because, you know, I'm looking at some monsters and things and that, you know, have spell abilities or things like that, you know, where I can strategize as a DM a little bit better, not just okay, here's a bunch of kobolds and they're just gonna, you know, mad rush you, or here's a bunch of, you know, goblins or orcs that are just you know, throwing a little bit of challenge here.
Yeah. So since you say it like that, it kind of reminds me of like a kid with a toy box. Like, you're the DM, you're the kid with the toy box. Mm-hmm. You get to go dig into your toy box and see what can you bring out to play with.
Yeah, it's kind of funny because I'm taking an adventure, actually. It's out of Ghost of the Salt Marsh is where this is actually coming from. But then I'm like looking at a couple of things where I might replace some of the monsters, some of the things that might be adding a couple things that might be kind of interesting or fun to see. So yeah, I'm getting to that point now where it's like, okay, I can fill this with these guys. Let's see what happens.
Yeah, I'm excited to see where we end up on this one.
And it's funny, only after like 2 days of planning, I feel more prepared now than I did having, what, like 2 weeks to prepare for like the last one, which I already had. You know, it's one of those things where I kind of was lazy because I read the story. I read the adventure. I knew it. But then it's kind of like, well, I haven't seen it for so long. I'm like, I know it, you know. And I'm like, oh, fuck, I don't remember this. Remember any of this?
That was my problem going into it, too, is I could not remember what we had done last in our first session picking back up this campaign.
I could remember it, but at the same time, I'm a give it to spellcasters. I had to go through like all those spells again and refigure it out because I'm just not used to it.
Yeah.
Spellcasters, too many options.
It is, yeah, really. Yeah, exactly. It is funny, though, because I went back and looked, and like, you guys missed so much. There was a vampire that had kind of a cool axe that might have been fun. There was, Garrett almost stumbled upon it. It was like this big, gigantic slug. Back in the one room where he found the necklace that said something about Lord of Snails.
I do vaguely remember that.
There was a were jaguar.
Ooh.
which was a spin-off of a were-tiger sort of thing. There was a couple of undead encounters. There was an Oni encounter.
I can't say I'm sad we missed that one.
The Oni?
Yeah.
Yeah.
At least there wasn't a Nothic, am I right?
That bitch Nothic.
Bitch Nothic. There was a couple other things, too, that I was like, oh, man, can I miss that?
This was our first, like, dungeon crawl. Like, we had that labyrinth and stuff like this, but I feel like this was, like, a more traditional dungeon crawl. And that's kind of like the disadvantage of creating a dungeon crawl, is you don't know which way people are going to go. Like, when you think about the labyrinth, we almost went straight to the path, you know what I mean? And then we took a left. You just don't know what people are going to do, right?
Exactly.
But I mean, we definitely still enjoyed it, even if we didn't have, even if we didn't see everything. I felt like we were a little overpowered for the things, so I was waiting for that one thing to show up that was like, give us a tough time, and holy crap!
And you kept messing them.
And we just kept looping around. Oh, it's like Phasmophobia. We just kept looping the ghost.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, the other thing is you guys are not. You guys need a Warwick in the group.
You know what?
That was.
I think Keegan honestly misses playing Warwick to play. I think he has the strategy for the Warforge. I think he can do that, but I think his personality I could see more towards Warwick.
Goddamn sales guys!
Right?
Because you were in the room with the. The were panther, whatever it was. Can't remember what it was. Jaguar, that's what it was.
I'm still super curious about the mirror room.
Oh, that one, there was a secret door you guys missed that led to nowhere. And there was one of the mirrors was supposed to trigger an orchid jelly. Or an ooze, yellow, one of the oozes, I can't remember which one it was. but yeah, I was supposed to summon one of those. Um, There was one, you guys went through it, and you're just kind of like, meh, whatever. This was a couple sessions ago, where it was like a set up to be like a soccer game, where a ball comes up. It was in the one of the long hallways, and there was like two holes in the middle of the, on either side of the hallway, and you had to get the little tether hall. It was kind of like a cross between soccer and basketball. And you had to hit the ball, and the ball would move, you know, towards the direction, but then there was an opponent that would try to get in the other end. It was kind of cool.
Alright. I mean, who knows? Maybe we'll go back. It's still an option, right?
I mean, it is, but...
We know where the entrance is, yeah.
Which is funny, because I actually was kind of preparing for you guys to go back in.
I honestly debated on it with Mordai. I thought, you know, as we came out, would Mordai, like, tell everybody we should just go back and do it again? But I don't know. I honestly, I had trouble playing Mordai. It just was not me. Also felt a lot of pressure. I hadn't felt that with Reed. You know, when I played Reed or anybody else's character, but for some reason Mordai, it intimidated me. It did.
Oh yeah.
I don't know. Just not used to it, I guess. He doesn't have many spell slots either. Like, doesn't have many spells or anything. It was just the whole, like, playing into the RP and the charisma of him. And I'm sorry, Garrett. I did not do you justice. I tried. I thought the invisibility thing was decent to go hide. But then, like, I felt like I didn't do too much then.
I can see him doing that. Kind of just sitting back, waiting in the weeds, literally and figuratively.
Yeah. I don't know. I back to the Warforged, I do enjoy that we have two tanks now up front. A healer and the backline damage dealers. I feel like we have a pretty spread out diverse group as well.
Yeah, we've got a pretty solid party.
The only thing you guys are missing is a rogue.
Yeah, for that high damage. But, I mean, we'll see. I don't know. I know we have some languages we're missing.
That was the other thing, is early on in I think maybe in the very first room, so a lot of the stuff was in a language that nobody knew. But Ashley actually has a scroll of understand that language. Mm-hmm. And it was like language. She took it, she picked it up, and I was like, it was specific to the language that was in this in this temple. And I'm sitting here like, Ashley, that's something of him. Yeah, there's a couple of things I was like, you guys are missing out.
little Easter eggs that we were missing, huh?
Uh-huh.
I mean, in our defense, we all still were, coming back to getting used to the characters and feeling things out and stuff. And so, and plus the RP, which I'll give Evan props real quick that he dove into. Like,
he does. Yeah.
Legion sounded a little bit like Nisana, I'm going to be honest. But nonetheless, I enjoyed, he was a little over the top as far as what I would do. But I enjoyed it.
I like it. No, I like it. I liked it.
I'm still waiting for Cleek's accent. That's all.
He's giving me a little bit of background stuff. I'm gonna play into here a little bit, I think. So
nice. Yeah. I mean, it's one of those things where I just don't know how far we're diving in, and I also don't want to get so excited about one campaign over the other that the other one falters.
Yeah.
So,
Just
trying to balance.
No, I get that. No, yeah, totally.
Back to it. There was a question that came up during, but I can't not remember it. And I feel like there was a question last week. I should start writing these down or something, right? I think there
was one about Shatter.
Okay, there was the definitely.
And I forgot to look that up.
Yeah, no biggie. But I don't think I feel like the question was a DMing question, but I just don't remember it. It's gonna come to me eventually. But anyway, so it's
I know.
Let's go.
Did it have to do with being able to kind of play, kind of DM as a more. Having to prepare more on virtually.
It was about the virtual difference, yeah, but I just could not remember the exact, the theater of the mind. It was that conversation. Mm-hmm. That, you know, you still could do theater of the mind. I mean, you don't have to pull up a screen. You could leave us on the map, mm-hmm. and you could do theater of the mind from a lot of it, but I do agree with what you were saying about the combat being a little bit more hands-on with the battle map and stuff right there.
Yeah, definitely.
So, do you feel like that is more preparation than your creation of battle map before?
Oh, definitely.
Yeah?
Definitely, because you could just randomly draw up a map on a dry erase board or whatever, and I could throw in an encounter, take me, a couple minutes throwing a counter together off the top of my head. I can't do that in Roll 20 without some kind of prep work. So, got to be Batman a little bit.
Yeah. I mean, I guess in theory, if you took the bio break right before you were revealing the map, that would give you like 5-10 minutes and you can grab some tokens and pull them on. You could do a skinny down version, but...
Mm-hmm.
Because I think Roll 20 has like a create your own battle map feature where you can like draw out stuff.
Yeah, it'd be hand drawn. It would have to be kind of hand drawn a little bit, but yeah.
Mm-hmm. What are you going to say, Rusty?
Yeah.
I can't say it would be the worst thing in the world either if, you had just sort of a default token, just a like a pawn or, a coin that says monster or something, and, that's. Could try to help you.
Yeah, and you could throw three monster tokens out there.
And then
hand draw the map. It could be done, I feel, if in a pinch. But I do agree with Eric here that, seeing that stuff and being able to count the squares and do the measurement does engage me a little bit more.
Yeah.
I mean, personally, for Roll 20, I have been trying to keep like my own, for lack of a better term, monster manual. And I have like a master game where I'm just accumulating monsters as I go, put them in there, and then I can drag and drop whenever I need to. So I'm getting to the point where I can do that. But I mean, I guess that's the other thing too, is if you actually purchase the Monster Manual or a couple of the other monster books on Roll 20, probably make life a little bit easier. But,
I know we do have some in the Campaign 1. I know that some have been purchased, but, we'll see as we progress. Maybe we'll add on to our collection, and it's not one of those things where you have to buy all of them first time. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
Sorry,
what was that, Rusty?
Yeah.
Sorry, you said something about collection. I said this will make a fine addition to my collection. Just adding bullshit.
All right, one more thing before we go into Siddle's Compendium of Magical Artifacts. How do you guys feel about characters and taglines? I've been trying for a long time to come up with a tagline for Amarok, and I'm just curious how you guys feel about it. Like, just something that they say, is that more of a character niche thing? Like, what do you guys feel?
I don't know. I gotta be honest. I think it's one of those spur of the moment things. Like, it's something you can't think about. I think it's something that when it happens, it happens.
Go eat a tree.
Like, go eat a tree.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
It kind of becomes your thing when it, yeah.
Yeah. All you right, can't right. force it.
I agree.
I want to see Griswold shove a tree down a Frost Giant's throat. As his, how are you going to do this? How do you want to do this?
I'm pretty sure him and I have talked about him using a tree before for the final blow. He's just got to get the final blow in the right environment.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see.
You know, and it was, you know, as I was putting stats together, too, it was good to see Legion, you know, he had a couple of hits, but then there was a couple times where, you know, Evan was Evan, and he was making comments, and then he'd roll a 9 and a 10.
Isn't it crazy how that happens to him? Like, uh-huh. Cocky Evan rolls for shit.
Yep. Uh-huh.
I don't get it. Like, if it's karma, if it's the balance out there in the universe, what it is, Cocky Evan rolls for shit.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's the Roll 20 gods listening. It's the D20 gods listening.
It's the only thing I can think of.
Or it's the story dice that we that we get so much out of it. I don't know. Because I don't want to talk shit about his dice rolling, because last time I did that, I rolled for crap the next three sessions. But that's karma. But he did. He rolled very well when he was RP and he wasn't cocky, mm-hmm. and then all of a sudden. Nat 1. Yep. Who did I hit? Yep. Roll a dex check.
Yep.
Again, story dice adds to it. But with that, let's go ahead and jump into Magic Item of the Week. Good.
All right. Got a trio of fun ones out of the magical randomized Excel spreadsheet. Almost combined spread and sheet into one little mashup there, anyway.
Sheet? Wait, spread and sheet. Spreet?
That was what was going to come out of my mouth, was spreet.
Okay.
I'm going to try and bring that into, like, regular vernacular now. I think that'd be kind of fun. Anyway.
It's like fetch.
Yeah. I'm going to make fetch happen, but spreet.
Spreet is still not happening.
First one up, Mask of the Beast. This is out of Tomb of Annihilation. An uncommon, wondrous item. Does not require attunement. This wooden mask, shaped in the likeness of a beast's visage, has three charges. While wearing the mask... Visage? How do you pronounce it? Whatever. While wearing the mask, you can spend...
Visage?
Okay. Thank you. It's one of those words I've only ever read, and I've never actually said out loud or heard said. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
While wearing a mask, you can expend one charge and use the mask to cast the Animal Friendship spell as an action. The mask regains all expended charges at dawn. You almost end up with like a pseudo-druid.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and you say that's the Mask of the Beast?
Yes.
Okay. I don't think I've heard of that one before, but it does sound pretty interesting. Little game I play in my head as you're telling me about it is who would use it, and now I feel like I have two parties to play with that play that game of who would use it with. I mean, obviously Griswold would go with this, which was my other question. All right, we'll come back to it.
All right. And just to read through the Animal Friendship spell. Spell lets you convince a beast that you mean no harm. Choose a beast you can see within range. It must see and hear you. If the beast's intelligence is 4 or higher, the spell fails. Otherwise, beast must succeed on a wisdom saving throw or be charmed by you for the spell's duration. If you or one of your companions harms the target, the spell ends. It has a duration of 24 hours, so... You can make some nice friends that way.
Yeah.
All right. Next up, Axe of the Dwarvish Lords.
Nice.
This one's straight out of the DMG. It is a battle axe and an artifact that requires attunement. Seeing the peril his people faced, a young dwarf prince came to believe that his people needed something to unite them. This is a long one, so buckle up. Thus, he set out to forge a weapon that would be such a symbol. venturing deep under the mountains, deeper than any dwarf had ever delved, the young prince came to the blazing heart of a great volcano. With the aid of Moradin, the dwarven god of creation, he first crafted four great tools: the brutal pick, the earth heart forge, the anvil of songs, and the shaping hammer. With them, he forged the axe of the dwarvish lords. Armed with the artifact, the prince returned to the dwarf clans and brought peace. His axe ended grudges and answered slights. The clans became allies, and they threw back their enemies and enjoyed an era of prosperity. This young dwarf is remembered as the first king. When he became old, he passed the weapon, which had become his badge of office, to his heir. The rightful inheritors passed the axe on for many generations. Later, in a dark era marked by treachery and wickedness, the axe was lost in a bloody civil war, fomented by greed for its power and the status it bestowed. Centuries later, the dwarves still search for the axe, and many adventurers have made careers of chasing after rumors and plundering old vaults to find it. This is a magic weapon. It's a magic weapon that grants a +3 bonus to attack and damage rolls made with it. The axe also functions as a belt of dwarvish kind, a dwarven thrower, and a sword of sharpness. It has a randomly chosen property. Between two minor beneficial properties, one major beneficial properties, and two minor detrimental properties. Blessings of Moradin. If you are a dwarf attuned to the axe, you gain the following benefits. You have immunity to poison damage. Range of your dark vision increases by 60 feet. You gain proficiency with... Yeah, right? You gain proficiency with artisan's tools related to blacksmithing, brewing, and stonemasonry. You end up with Conjure Earth Elemental. If you are holding the axe, you can use your action to cast the Conjure Elemental spell from it, summoning an Earth Elemental. You can't use this property again until the next dawn. Next one, Travel the Depths. You can use this action to touch the axe to a fixed piece of dwarvish stonework and cast the Teleport spell from the axe. If your intended destination is underground, there is no chance of mishap or arriving somewhere unexpected. You can't use this property again until 3 days have passed. Curse. The axe bears a curse that affects any non-dwarf that becomes attuned to it. Even if the attunement ends, the curse remains.
I was thinking, give it to Grizz.
With each passing day, the creature's physical appearance and stature become more dwarf-like. Oh my god, Grizz just shrinks. After 7 days, the creature looks like a typical dwarf, but the creature neither loses its racial traits nor gains the racial traits of a dwarf. That would be the funniest Goliath in history.
You know what? That actually hilarious. Might help the party a little bit if he shrunk down.
Yeah.
Yeah, right? The physical changes wrought by the axe aren't considered magical in nature and therefore can't be dispelled. But they can be undone by any effect that removes a curse, such as Greater Restoration or Remove Curse spell. Last one, Destroying the Axe. The only way to destroy the axe is to melt it down in the Earthheart Forge where it was created. It must remain in the Burning Forge for 50 years before it is finally... Before it finally succumbs to the fire and is consumed. I mean, there's really an obvious choice for who this would go to.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Griswold, of course, but, yeah. You know. Griswold.
Or maybe Mordai.
Maybe Mordai.
Feel like it wouldn't be as funny for Mordai because he's not, like, large. The shrinking effect wouldn't be as. But that would be hilarious.
Just watch Grizz shrink over the course of a week.
And we all agree not to tell him.
Yeah. Like, am I getting shorter? I don't know what you're talking about.
We're getting taller.
No, you're just as big as you always were. That's a cool one. That'd be I would go on a hunt for that thing.
Yeah, that's definitely end game. That's a definitely epic level.
Oh yeah, artifact. For sure.
Cool. +3
Mm-hmm.
+3, yes sir.
I'm thinking like, holy crap, +3. You could take that and go, great weapon master, and it would nullify it. And you would just have, like, because you lose that the +5 to or -5 to your attack.
Oh
And then you get the plus three from the axe, and it's like, okay, cool. No matter what I roll, I hit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very cool
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, and you're adding plus damage. Yeah. Taking a hit to hit, but gaining, like, plus 10 to damage or something like that?
Yeah, exactly. So plus 10 plus the 3 of the axe itself, because it's plus 3 to hit, plus 3 to damage. So, I mean, like, you're putting out some damage with that.
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And not to mention, whatever the minor beneficial and major beneficial properties are.
Mm-hmm. Being able to also cast teleport elemental and stuff. Yeah, that'd be a pretty cool bonus. I think the best for it would be Barbarian Dwarf, to be honest, if you're a Barbarian Dwarf, because then you get the advantage, and you could take Great Weapon Master and the plus 3, and you would have that the odds in your favor to constantly be putting out immense damage.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
What else you got?
All right, last one, and there's no scroll bar on this page, so I will not be rambling for like 5 minutes. Last one is the Rod of Resurrection. This is a legendary item that requires attunement by a cleric, druid, or paladin straight out of the DMG. This rod has 5 charges. While you hold it, you can use an action to cast one of the following spells from it. Heal, which expends 1 charge, or Resurrection, which expends 5 charges. The rod regains 1 expended charge daily at dawn. The rod is reduced to 0 charges. Roll a d20. On a 1, the rod disappears in a burst of radiance. So that's a gamble if you got to use Resurrection.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, that's pretty good. That can resurrect anything. Mm-hmm. Anything that has been dead for less than a century, as long as it is not undead and didn't die of old age.
Yeah, it's not raised dead, it's not revivified, it's resurrected, which is,
So, quick question about that then, since this staff, or this rod, grants you this ability, you still have to use the spell components, right?
No.
Wow.
In a wand, no. Because the thought is you use the spell components in the creation of the wand.
Ah, got it. Okay. So there's a 1,000 gold piece diamond in there somewhere then.
If
not more. That's like scrolls then, right? Where the components were used to make it.
Yeah.
That one's pretty end game as well.
Yeah.
So how about some of the other things? I'm going to go through a couple of points on Resurrection real quick. So it doesn't remove any magical diseases, curses, and such. When you come back, target has a -4 penalty to all attack rolls, saving throws, ability checks. Penalty is reduced by 1 until on each long rest. So, the last one here is casting the spell to restore life to a creature that has been dead for 1 year or longer taxes you greatly. Until you finish a long rest, you cannot cast spells again, and you have disadvantage on all attack rolls, ability checks, and saving throws. So, does that still affect someone who is using this spell as a result of the rod?
That's a good question. I would probably say no, because again, you're casting it through the rod. You're not really.
I guess that magical energy, that power is still in there, or is already in there.
Yeah, that's what I would say.
I'm sure somebody on the interwebs has asked that question, and if we get it wrong, they'll let us know.
Maybe.
They always do, man. They always do.
awesome items. I really like those final two. They are final game items, but you just like to hear about those end game items sometimes, because it's kind of cool. I'd be itching to have that axe as Amrook. I just, the damage output, like, yeah.
Oh yeah.
But all right, it's time for Stats Chat of the Week.
Stats Chat!
All right. With that, let's go ahead and turn on. If I can. There it is. All right. So you guys can't see it, but it is on stream if you're interested. We're starting off with the latest encounter, some of those things, because, you know, up until this point, Kalik has really been the most consistent killer out of all of us. Mordai doing, you know, a fireball on a group of skeletons, but now that we have, you know, Emerald and Nine, as I call them, I think these kills are starting to disperse a little bit more, or we're facing, and I just don't know. Do you feel like the damage gets distributed differently so Kleek doesn't gather all the kills, or why do you think that is, that the kills distribute as we gain more and as we gain more damage? Any idea? Because, I mean, as I'm looking at the charts, Jack is the highest killer, which, I mean, awesome, Jack, but didn't expect. And then we, like, pretty much everybody has won, I mean, except for Barry and Mordai. So I pretty much did nothing this this past session. The previous session, I got 3 kills. But this past session, I didn't do anything.
Yeah, I don't know. You did some damage with Toll the Dead.
Toll the Dead always does decent, consistent damage because it's one of those saves that, you know, they mm-hmm. most creatures lack, and that's why it's kind of like my go-to. Yeah. It's an easy one. Mm-hmm. That and I do want to play that supportive role and not the damage dealer, not the strategist. That was my question earlier, so I'm going to jump into it. I know it's Stats Chat, but I can't help it. I'm going to forget it again. Do you feel... As from going from campaign 1 to campaign 2, back to campaign 1, and now finally back to campaign 2, that we as D&D players have changed a little bit? Because I'm looking at it like when we first started this, Evan, Keegan, some others were very gold and magic item hungry, and these past 2 sessions I don't think it was brought up other than that wand. So do you feel
definitely from a from an outsider, I guess. Look, I definitely can see growth in how you guys play, how you guys build your characters a little bit, even creating. I want to say maybe it was Evan. Some of the spells, he's like, oh, I want to change some of my spells up because, you know, you're limited as a warlock and as a sorcerer, you're limited to the number of spells that you know. So you kind of want to diversify, right? You want to try to have, you know, as your cantrips, you want to have one good damage, maybe a good support type spell. And, you know, you don't want everything to be damage. Because you can only do that, you know, you can only do that for so much. Where it's like, oh man, I wish I had this spell. I wish I had that spell. And I'm definitely seeing that from everybody. Like, okay, we're switching spells up a little bit. So, okay, I have like one damage spell, one support spell, one oh shit spell, kind of thing. When it comes to spellcasters. But yeah, I definitely think. There's definitely some
player growth.
I guess. Yeah.
Yeah, I completely agree, and I noticed that this past session. I didn't notice it too much the session before, but this past session, I just, you know, other than, you know, there was some gold talk, there was, you know, the wand, but other than that, it wasn't like a, it was just a different feel, and mm-hmm. you know, I feel like, you know, I don't know. Just my thoughts. Rusty, what do you have?
Go ahead.
I think this just kind of goes back to the point earlier where, you know, we're all relatively experienced players at this point.
2 years. Are we, though?
Well, I mean, relative compared to when we started Storm King... Well, started
Wave Echo Cave.
Lost Mine of Phandalin.
Yeah.
No.
Phandelver.
Phandelver, thank you. I knew that wasn't right. But, you know, compared to when we started that, you know, the only person who had any experience, any real experience, you know, I had played a couple of one-shots, but, you know, obviously Eric's played for decades at this point. you know, definitely have a lot more experience and know what works and what doesn't more so than when we created our first characters.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I still love my first character, don't get me wrong.
Oh, absolutely. Oh, absolutely. But, you know.
I think I could grow to, you know, have that same connection and investment in Barry, though. I could see it. I could see it. I may not quite be there, but I could definitely see it.
Yeah. I was going to make a point or say something, too, about the fact of, you know, that we don't... This group doesn't have the rogue and doesn't have Warwick that are kind of gold-driven. You guys are more...
be virtue or mission-driven or...
Mission-driven, almost stat... Well, Mordai is status-driven, I would say.
I could see that.
Him and his Whisper campaign.
Yeah, I could see that, and I guess it's just a difference in, you know, characters themselves and what drives the characters, and now we're playing these other ones, and so you just see things differently. Because I can definitely see, you know, Amaruk being on the other side of status, moral, virtue driven, as opposed to Barry, who's I'm just along for the ride. I'm here to help Cleek do his mission, you know, and so that's just two completely different things, so that makes you play differently as well. So maybe it is something about the characters and that change, or maybe it's a combination between character change and player growth. Who knows? But all right, back to the stats chat. so I was looking at the attacking. So this session we did 263. I think I looked at this earlier. No, not here. Oh, it's in the all encounters. Duh.
You gotta undo that.
I got you. All right. All encounters 263.
Oh, okay.
And then if I go back to, or if I go to the one before, it's 370. So we actually have done a shit ton of damage. I don't know about you, Cleek, Rusty. I feel like we're pounding the shit out of different things, and we're just doing so much damage. And it's crazy to think that our other campaign, we do about that much damage. Like in the Nasana fight, we did about that much damage, you know, 400 damage. And we still do the same amount of damage over here in campaign two. Is that weird, or is that just me?
I haven't thought about that. That's wild.
Yeah, I mean, the damage charts are pretty close. I mean, granted, there are a lot more encounters. Like, that was, you know, pretty much one encounter, as opposed to this one was several encounters. And you know, I'm sure if I went back to, I don't know if we have the stats from Mordai's bombshell on the skeletons, I'm sure that those damage charts are pretty high, too.
Yeah, if you go to the blank on the episode,
and then under encounter,
because I don't have the episodes.
463, just in the Hall of Zombies.
Yeah.
So I mean, that's crazy. That's one fireball.
Mm-hmm.
Oh shoot, that's funny.
Not to toot my own horn, but if you go to the last. The episode 13.
Yeah.
What the heck did I call it?
Back to Baldur's Gate.
No, the one before that.
Cleek's Mummy?
Yeah, Cleek's Mummy.
Did you like that one?
My
favorite. Oh, jeez.
No, hold on, though. Go to the
encounters.
My favorite.
High upon a grassy knoll. Is, all right.
No. In the cliques.
Oh, okay. Okay. Go to sorry. Cliques. Century 3?
Century 3. Chevrolet. Century 3.
That's amazing.
I do like that. That's comical. That's comical. I mean, I like all of these. Itsy Bitsy Spider. I did like this one, the High Upon a Grassy Knoll, because of the knolls. Mm-hmm. I mean,
the knolls.
Yeah. I like it. Like it a lot. I just wanted to see the last encounter being attacked by damage. 67. We really did not get hurt much in comparison to the amount of damage we do.
No.
I think that's going to be fixed here soon. We're going to see.
Maybe.
Barry's got his healing spells ready. Don't you worry.
And I gotta say, I've been keeping track of Mordai's inspiring leader and putting that in the healing, and that's.
I saw that as well. I was gonna get there.
That's impressive.
Yeah, because I was a little jealous. I'm the healer, dude. Back off. I also wanted to look at, so one thing we are missing in this that we have in the other stats chat is the funnel chart on the front screen to see who's in the highest damage club. So we may have to circle back to that, but I did want to show Mordai still at the top with 600 damage. Cleek not far behind him, 15, but Jack, he's going to close in on you. I feel it. Because he gets two, he's going to get two attacks at, or no, he has two attacks now at level 5 as a fighter. I feel it. He's going to come up, and Emerald and Legion I could see coming up as well. Nine, he's going to be in the middle somewhere, pretty consistent damage. I like it. That's what we need. Him and Barry, we'll do the hard work. You guys get all the glory. I get it. We're the linemen of the group.
Yeah, you know, and I think he has opportunity to do some damage, though. He hasn't raged yet.
Oh, that's true. I always forget he's a barbarian because I just think of him as a tank. Mm-hmm. So I can't wait till he gets into that. So, yeah, no, he could catch up pretty easily, too. You guys better start thinking about how you're going to stay ahead. That's all I'm saying.
Jack has some archer capabilities that he's... only kind of dabbled in a little bit. So
he's only got 24 arrows that left, though. I was waiting for him as we stopped at, or mm-hmm. as we came to the town. I was waiting. Are you going to pick up some more arrows? But I didn't want to be that mm-hmm. guy trying to hold my tongue, you know, not be the rules lawyer. Mm-hmm. But I did notice he only has 24 arrows left because I like that.
I was actually waiting for him to see if he could recover any of his arrows combat.
After the null fight, right? You thought... Mm-hmm. I didn't say it again, but yeah. No, I was waiting to see, because his drunk ass is going to run out of arrows.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I guess I'll just stab something.
Just beats him with his bow.
But yeah, I had to stop at the damage charts just to point out Mordai not in the lead by much, and Cleek and Mordai, you know. Speaking from... the past here with Amrook, it's tough to stay ahead. You know, Siddle just came up on me quick, so you got to figure out how you're going to stay in the lead if you want to stay in the lead. That's all I'm saying. Mm-hmm. If we switch over to the healing, if we look at the ability healing, 176 points of healing. That's crazy. And so that is Mordai.
Yeah, that's 11 or 10. What, 10 or 11 hit points? Per person, every time you guys take a rest?
Yeah. It's 176 points. So that is like our biggest one. Mm-hmm. Other than that, it's Cure Wounds at like 37. It's not even close. Mm-hmm. Oof. Mordai, you better back the fuck off. That's all I'm saying. I'm the healer of the group. Me and the druid. We'll see. I'm telling you, soon as our druid starts casting... healing spirit, Mordai is going to be left in the dust.
I don't know. Ashley's more the damaging druid. She hasn't even brought out her wildfire spirit yet.
I did notice that she's more of a damage dealing druid, but I was curious, mm-hmm. like, you know, at that point of crap, everybody around me is getting hurt. Do you just use the healing spell out of necessity? And then you're like, oh, that worked out pretty well. Like, you know, cause you may or may not plan it. I don't know.
Yeah. Necessity. What the heck is the saying?
Necessity is the mother of all invention.
Mother of all inventions. So. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I planned to be healing for the most part. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I'm still going to cast Bless and stuff. I'm not just going to heal people when they don't need it. But I don't know how she planned it. So we'll see. I'm interested. And then I'm not going to jump into individual stats too much. I did look at, of course, Barry himself. But it's hard to really gauge where we're at just because number of attacks and stuff are still pretty low. So I'm waiting for that stuff to level out itself. But
right.
Very good job, Eric. I enjoy the stats. You guys got anything to wrap up stats chat?
No, I'm just... I am just trying to think my way through how I'm going to get my lead back and maintain it.
There you go. I mean, I mentioned it, I think, before Eric even got on, that, you know, I felt like the last two sessions, Cleek just was not outputting the damage that he was earlier on in the campaign. The first couple levels, we're like, holy crap, this monk is just, like, killing everything. Last two sessions, Cleek, you got to pick it up. That's all I'm saying.
I know. Got to get those numbers up.
Well, you know, what's funny is there was, I think I even made comment during the session was, I think he only did 11 points of damage one round. Well, and then the one round, you were stuck throwing darts, and that's not your forte.
Yeah.
So any round that I can have Cleek get no damage is a win for the DM.
Start having a tally chart.
Uh-huh.
Just like the tally chart we had until Siddle got his gloves back, his gauntlets back.
I do still really enjoy just making jokes about that to Evan.
I mean, who doesn't? I think Evan is starting to enjoy making jokes about it. Let's be honest. All right, with that, we'll go ahead and wrap it up. Thank you, everybody, for watching, and we'll see you on Sunday, I hope? ?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, I should be good. Yeah, I'm a little excited about this, because, I'm getting the gears going here myself instead of just taking the adventures and plopping them down. I'm kind of modifying them a little bit, so.
Awesome.
That's when it gets fun. We'll see you on Sunday for Minesweeper. Thanks, everybody.